Recorded Books presents Country Born by Linda Lael Miller. Narrated by Jack Garrett. Chapter 1. Sara's call had come through at 6 a.m. sharp, jolting J.P. McCall a little, even though he was a lifelong rancher and thus an early riser. Sara was, after all, the sister of one of his two closest friends, Eli Garrett, the current sheriff of Wild Horse County, Montana, a man with a dangerous job. And it didn't help that she opened with a breathless, "This is an emergency, J.P." "What is it?" he'd asked, hoarse with alarm. "What's going on?" In moments like that, his PTSD, a relic of his tour of duty in Afghanistan, always spiked. Fortunately, such moments were relatively rare. He still had the occasional nightmare, and sometimes a loud, unexpected noise triggered a dizzying rush of adrenaline, pure fight or flight. When that happened, he went off by himself and breathed his way back to the real world. "I've completely forgotten how it feels to ride a horse," she blurted anxiously. If J.P. hadn't thought as highly of Sara Worth as he did, he probably would have cut her off at the knees, and attractive knees they were, for scaring him half to death. Sara, who wrote under the pen name Luke Cantrell, was the successful author of two Western thrillers, featuring a Clint Eastwood-type hero named Elliot Starr, with another book currently in the works, according to Eli. Clearly, she did thorough research. "Seriously, Sara, that's your emergency?" He'd sounded irritated, but in actuality, he was swamped with relief. The county under Eli's jurisdiction was a peaceable place, for the most part, with a relatively low crime rate, considering its size. But it definitely had its share of losers and troublemakers. Just last winter, Eli was taken by surprise in his own backyard, savagely attacked and very nearly killed. Eli was a friend J.P. couldn't lose, like Cord Hollister, the third member of the rowdy triad. The three of them had been tight since kindergarten, and the bond between them ran deep, like the roots of an ancient tree tangled with bedrock. They were more than friends. They were blood brothers. There was a silence, a very awkward one. J.P. had looked down at his retired service dog, Trooper, standing beside him in the tall, dew-dampened grass between the barn and the house, instantly alert, ready for trouble. "It's all right, boy," he'd told the dog. "At ease." For several seconds after that, no one spoke. Then, sounding chagrined, Sara had murmured, "Oops. I guess my enthusiasm for accuracy got away from me. I'm sorry if I worried you, J.P." She knew about his combat injuries, of course, and the subsequent case of PTSD that, though mostly under control, still sneaked up on him at times. As a child, Sara had been a tomboy, and she'd sometimes hung around with Eli and, by extension, J.P. and Cord. She'd garnered a lot of information along the way, having sat around campfires with her brother's friends, fished in Painted Pony Creek with them, raced barefoot down rocky country roads with them, often winning. For a while, after his honorable discharge from the military, he'd even had a crush on her, might even have pursued a relationship with her, if she hadn't fallen for an outsider named Zachary Worth and eventually married him. "I'm revising my manuscript," Sara had explained in a burst when J.P. didn't immediately respond to her apology. "Technically, it was due last week, and I just realized that the scenes where the characters are on horseback don't ring true at all. I know it sounds crazy since I've already written two books in the same series, but there it is. It just doesn't feel right." "Okay," he'd muttered, stretching out the word. He could let this go. He just had to breathe, and then breathe some more. He had wondered why she'd come to him with a problem instead of Cord, for instance. Cord was literally world-renowned for his methods of training both horses and riders. And then there was Emma Grant, Cord's wife Shally's best friend, who ran a therapeutic riding academy and could therefore provide whatever instruction Sara needed. "I know what you're thinking," Sara had rattled on. "I could have gotten a few quick lessons from Cord or from Emma. The trouble is, the Hollisters are away visiting Shally's mom in Florida, and Emma has back-to-back classes booked, which leaves her with zero free time." "All right," JP had finally capitulated. "Come on out to the ranch, and we'll saddle up and ride." Now, an hour later, here she was, standing in front of JP's barn, clad in jeans, an old sweatshirt, and boots that looked a little too new. Her dark hair, plaited into a single braid that reached almost to her slender waist, gleamed in the sunlight, and her silver-gray eyes were bright with eager determination. With considerable help from JP, she'd saddled Misty, a bay mare so tame that JP's citified nieces, Becky and Robin, rode her bareback whenever they visited the ranch. His favorite gelding, Shiloh, was tacked up as well and ready to ride, nickering and sidestepping with impatience. "I insist on paying for your time, JP," Sara said, setting her jaw. "Don't even bother to argue the point. This is research, and as such, it's tax deductible." JP managed not to roll his eyes. "I'm not exactly short on money, Sara," he pointed out, with the slightest twitch of a grin tugging at one corner of his mouth. He'd received a modest settlement from the government after being badly injured in Afghanistan back in the day. And during the long months he'd spent recovering, he'd studied the stock market in depth and found that he had an uncanny knack for picking winners. Between that and his one-third stake in the family ranch, which he managed well, he was a wealthy man. She was about to mount Misty, one booted foot already in the stirrup, both hands gripping the saddle horn, when she turned her head to look back at him over one shoulder. She smiled, and something shifted inside JP, sweet and poignant, soft as the brush of a moth's wing. "Don't try to talk me out of it," she warned cheerfully. "I know you're bullheaded, JP McCall, but I'm a Garrett, remember? We're notoriously single-minded, as I'm sure you've noticed." JP gave a rumbling chuckle, but he was still shaken. He wasn't a fanciful man, and this new element, whatever it was, left him off balance, inwardly anyway. "We can argue all day," he pointed out, surprised that he sounded like his ordinary Montana rancher self. "Or we can ride." "Let's get on with the research," Sara urged, grinning. Then she hoisted herself off the ground, left foot in the stirrup, right leg ready to swing over Misty's broad back. JP did a little research of his own, watching her shapely blue-jeaned backside as she swung somewhat laboriously up into the saddle. She settled herself, sunlight rimming her like a golden aura, and looking up at her, JP was nearly blinded. The phenomenon wasn't entirely physical, and that confounded him further. It was ridiculous, reacting like this, he decided, annoyed with himself. Sara was Eli's sister, his big sister. She had two kids, courtesy of her no-good, long-gone husband. And though she must have had opportunities, she'd shown no interest, as far as JP knew anyway, in finding another husband or even a boyfriend. She seemed content to raise her son and daughter, write her books, and take part in community projects with her friends. But wasn't she ever lonely, in a crowd or by herself, at odd hours of the night? JP certainly was, though he was more than reluctant to admit as much. Those bleak bouts, like the infrequent but fiery, bloody flashbacks he sometimes endured, were among the many things he liked to forget. With no other blood kin, her and Eli's folks had died when Sara was in middle school, and a few years later their guardian and aunt, Abigail Garrett, had passed away as well. Sara had focused on her children. She'd had some kind of falling out with her former father-in-law, a very wealthy man who owned vast stretches of land around Painted Pony Creek, but rarely spent time in his secluded castle of a mansion, and apparently severed any and all ties with her ex-husband's family. Naturally, Eli had helped out as best he could, but he'd been busy in those days, finishing up at the police academy down in Phoenix, and then starting his career as a deputy sheriff. Sara had remained in Painted Pony Creek, missing out on college, but educating herself in a variety of creative ways. Until recently, she'd worked in a daycare facility, having stuck with the job in the early days when Eric and Haley were little so she could be near them. Always a voracious reader, Sara had eventually begun to write books of her own, pounding away at a keyboard before and after work, keeping her own counsel. JP, as close as he was to Eli, hadn't known about that part of her life until a few months ago, when her second novel had made a big splash in the marketplace. Even now, very few people knew that Luke Cantrell, purveyor of gritty historical thrillers, was really Sara Garrett Worth. She'd landed an impressive multi-book contract after these successes. JP had no idea how much money she made, and it wouldn't have occurred to him to ask. But she still kept a low profile professionally, preferring to live quietly in Painted Pony Creek. Through Eli, JP knew she'd managed her money wisely, setting up trust funds for her kids, paying off her mortgage, and making a few improvements to her brick ranch house in town. Apparently, unlike many of the newly prosperous, Sara didn't seem interested in the usual trappings of wealth. World travel, costly jewelry, designer clothes, fancy houses and cars. Not that there was anything wrong with those things. People had the right to spend what they'd earned however they chose. She was different, that's all. Sara lived in the same house she'd bought after Zachary left her, using part of the inheritance she and Eli had shared following the death of their parents to make a substantial down payment. JP knew this about Sara, not because Eli had confided in him, but because in small communities like the Creek, people picked up on things like that, as if by osmosis. It occurred to JP in those moments of daylight reflection that he and Sara had a few things in common, at least when it came to how they spent and didn't spend their money. Now, looking up at Sara, he realized that he'd known her better than he thought he had, though he'd never bothered to look too far beyond the obvious. Sister of one of his two best friends, divorcee, mother of two, and now best-selling author. Why hadn't he taken more notice of her? Well, he'd sure as hell taken notice of her now. The question was, where did he go from here? Should he follow his gut instinct and try to get to know Sara as a person, rather than just a background character in his life story? Or should he leave her alone, spare her the drawbacks of getting involved with a man like him, a man with scars, inside and out? JP? Sara asked, gazing down at him from within the halo gleaming around her. Are you all right?
I'm fine, he lied somewhat gruffly.
With that, he turned to his gelding, swung up into the saddle, and gathered the reins. He gave Sara a sidelong look.
Let's go, Luke, he teased.
Now that he was mounted on Shiloh, he felt like himself again, firmly planted inside his body instead of slightly out of alignment with it. Sara laughed. Don't forget, she said, I'm actually a greenhorn, a total fraud when it comes to boot-in-the-stirrups type stuff. With a motion of his hand, JP saluted her.
I wouldn't go that far, he replied easily.
Sara might not have a lot of confidence in herself as a rider, but she wasn't a raw beginner either. He knew she'd ridden with Shally on occasion, and like him, she'd helped out over at Emma Grant Stables, working with kids. He let Sara lead the way, and she soon eased Misty into a gentle trot across the expanse of the rolling pasture land. JP kept up, as did Trooper, who, though not as agile as he'd once been, seemed to be enjoying the fresh air, the rich green smell of good Montana grass, and the earthy scent of fertile land. The famous Big Sky was a cloudless dome overhead,
edged in the distance by timbered mountains. This was home, this wide open space. This was the place he longed for whenever he was away, the place that had healed him, body and soul, after endless, painful months in a military hospital back east. He drew it in deep, like a soul breath. As the minutes passed, Sara seemed to relax in the saddle, loosening her grip on the reins, taking in her surroundings instead of focusing on the space between Misty's twitching ears. They didn't speak. It didn't seem necessary out here, where the sky and the breeze and the whispering grass spoke in a language all their own. When they reached Painted Pony Creek, the broad stream for which the town was named, they let the horses drink. Meanwhile, Trooper dashed up and down the muddy bank, chasing a handful of butterflies, as happy as any dog could wish to be. Watching him, JP smiled. He loved that mutt, and he didn't care who knew it. "I appreciate this, JP," Sara said quietly, leaning forward a little, causing the saddle leather to creak and patting Misty's long, sweaty neck. "It's no big deal," JP answered, though God help him, it was a big deal. She drew a deep breath, seemed to relish it. "Sometimes I wish I'd raised Eric and Haley in the country instead of in town," she said. He wanted to hear more. "Why?" Sara raised her shoulders in a shrug-like motion, lowered them again. "I don't know, really, except that all this open space offers a special kind of freedom. No sidewalks, no paved parking lots, no traffic lights or crosswalks or supermarkets."
"I guess it's coming back to you," JP observed.
She looked at him. "Growing up in the country?"
"That and what it feels like to ride a horse," he said with a smile.
Sara and Eli's folks hadn't owned a big spread like the Hollisters and the McCalls and a number of other families around Painted Pony Creek, but they'd raised their family outside of town just the same. Before and after the loss of their parents, Sara and her brother had lived much as JP and Cord had as kids, doing chores, swimming in the creek, riding and camping out, running barefoot through long, hot summers. She stared pensively at the creek then, watching it tumble and swirl past, on its way to join half a dozen larger streams, then rivers. "There are a lot of things I wish I'd done differently," she said. "With the kids, I mean."
"Like what?"
Sara shook her head, and it seemed she was looking inward now. "Haley will be fine. She's so even-tempered and practical. But I worry about Eric." JP recalled the trouble Eric had gotten into a couple of years before, when he'd hooked up with a bunch of budding criminals, released some livestock, among other offenses, and wound up in trouble with the law. The kid had done some community service after he was caught, and as far as JP knew, straightened out. The boy looked up to his uncle, Eli, and that, along with Sarah's tough love, had probably been his saving grace. He might have ended up like his pal Freddie Lansing, though. JP shuddered slightly, remembering the day he and Eli and Melba Summers, a deputy at the time, had found the Lansing kid dead, hanging from a rafter in an old barn right there on the McCall Ranch. Since then, JP had had the place bulldozed, the weathered boards and beams and shingles hauled away to be burned.
"Is there any particular reason to worry about Eric?" he asked carefully.
It was none of his business, and he didn't want to cross any personal boundaries. But if Sara wanted someone to confide in, he was willing to listen. Sara smiled, looking slightly wistful. "No, he's behaving well enough," she said. Then, with a rueful chuckle, she added, "For a teenager." The horses had drunk their fill by then, and they were tossing their heads, ready to be on the move again. The land was their natural habitat, after all. Maybe they had some kind of genetic memory, some recollection of ancient days before the West was settled, when they'd run free and wild. Or maybe the Mustangs, still wild and multiplying with every passing year, served to remind them of how life had been
once upon a time. Genetic memory of the equine variety.
I guess I'm ready to head for home, Sara said. I don't want to take up too much of your time, and I need to get back to my manuscript.
Privately, JP reflected that it hadn't taken the woman long to achieve her purpose, but he didn't comment. Back at the house, after he'd unsaddled the gelding and the mare and turned them out to graze with the rest of his horses, he'd probably go online, check the current status of the market, maybe make a few adjustments to his portfolio. Then he'd climb into his truck and make the 15-minute drive to his folks' corner of the ranch and the log A-frame they'd retired to, once JP took over the nuts and bolts of the family cattle operation. The senior McCalls, John and Sylvia, were healthy, active, and thoroughly independent, but JP liked to check on them every so often just the same. His older sisters, Claire and Josie, lived in California and Virginia, respectively, and they'd expected regular reports on the state of the parental units via text or social media. They didn't entirely trust the pair to speak up if they needed help or simply wanted some company. Sara brought JP back to the present moment with a soft, "Is it enough for you, this ranch, I mean? Maybe I'm overstepping here, but don't you get lonely?" JP was surprised by the questions, but oddly not offended. Now that Eli and Cord were both happily married and starting families, lots of people probably wondered when he would follow suit. God knew his parents and sisters weren't shy about asking, though he always responded with varying degrees of annoyance that they ought to mind their own business.
"Everybody gets lonely sometimes," he replied after a few moments of silence.
The barn was in sight now, and the horses were picking up speed, ready to join the small herd grazing on tall, sweet grass.
"I shouldn't have asked," Sara said quickly, obviously uncomfortable.
JP smiled, but sparely.
"It's okay, Sara," he replied.
The truth was he did get lonely, especially at night, and he wanted a wife and family too. It was just that he wasn't willing to settle when it came to love. He dated a lot, mostly women from other towns, but marriage was something else. He wanted what his mom and dad had together, what Cord had with Shally, and Eli had with Bryn, a true bond, so deep and so sacred that it seemed predestined, cosmic in scope. So far, he hadn't met the right woman. In fact, he sometimes wondered if she was out there at all. Or, assuming she was, if he'd be the right man for her. He'd almost been a father once, though. Nearly 3 years ago, on the proverbial dark and stormy night, he'd been engaged in a poker game with Eli and Cord in the back room of Sully's Bar and Grill, when the door had burst inward and a skinny, drowned rat of a girl had appeared out of nowhere. She'd looked so much like Reba Shannon, the wild child who had nearly wrecked the trio of friends for good 17 years before, that JP had thought, for a fraction of a second, that he was seeing an actual ghost. Her name was Carly. She'd just hitchhiked halfway across the country, and she'd landed in their lives like a hand grenade with the pin pulled and announced, once the shock of her arrival had subsided a little, that one of the three of them, he, Eli, or Cord, was her biological dad. That long-ago summer of Carly's conception, when he and both his friends had fallen for Reba, each one believing, with the hormonal hubris of a 17-year-old boy, that they were her one and only, had almost faded from their combined memories by the time the girl showed up. Said girl had grown up and come looking not so much for a father, but for explanations. A series of events, some fortunate and some not, had ensued, and when the fat lady sang, so to speak, it turned out that Cord had been the one to sire this spirited little spitfire. Like Eli's, JP's reaction to the news had been mixed. He'd been relieved, naturally, but he'd also been disappointed. Rock-solid man that he was, Cord had stepped up, taken responsibility, worked at getting to know his daughter. He'd married his wife, Shally, and the three of them had created a family. Now they had another child, Cord and Shally, and they were beyond happy together. JP didn't envy his friends. He was glad for them. But he wanted what they had, for sure. A wife and kids of his own. A family.
"Where did you go just now, JP McCall?" Sara asked as the two of them dismounted. "You seem awfully distracted this morning."
It wasn't a criticism, only a comment. He knew that by her expression and her tone of voice. He grinned, took Misty's reins from Sara, and led both animals into the cool, hay-scented shade of the barn, where he proceeded to remove their saddles and bridles. Sara, obviously a little saddle sore, limped alongside him, ready to help. Instead of offering a belated answer to Sarah's inquiry, JP countered with, "What about you, Sara? You've been divorced for a long time. Your kids are growing up. Don't you ever get lonely?" Sara leaned down to scratch behind Trooper's floppy ears. The dog was leaning into her right leg, goofy with sudden adoration. JP could relate. Sara gave a rueful laugh, shook her head. "The kids have taken up so much of my time and energy," she replied, "that I haven't had a chance to get lonely." He hung up the bridles, placed the saddles and blankets where they belonged.
"Eric must be about to start college," he said.
Sara ran her palms down the thighs of her trim jeans, sighed. "He's a senior this year. Again." She paused, winced. "It had to do with that bad patch he went through. He let his grade slip so badly that he didn't qualify to graduate with the rest of his class." JP remembered the bad patch, and he could identify. He'd had a few of those himself, times when he'd checked out, both physically and emotionally, after the roadside explosion in Afghanistan that wounded him and killed half a dozen of his friends. His recovery, a grim and deliberate process of coming back to himself, had been long, painful, and difficult on every level. Not that he'd put the struggle entirely behind him. It was, he supposed, a big part of the reason he'd avoided emotional intimacy with the many women he'd wined and dined since his recovery. He was afraid that if he ever let his shadow side show, he'd scare them away. Or worse, that they'd stick around, trying to save him.
"I know a little about Eric's troubles," he said at some length as they walked side by side out into the sunlight.
Misty and Shiloh followed amiably along behind them, eager to reach the pasture. JP moved to open the gate, and both horses hurried through the opening, snorting and kicking up their hind legs as soon as he'd detached the lead ropes from their harnesses. He chuckled at this display of equine delight, pulled the gate closed and made sure the latch caught, draping the lead ropes over one shoulder. Sara looked pained, attempted a mild stretch, and flinched visibly.
"You'll be sore for a few days," JP observed unnecessarily.
"I need to get more exercise," Sara confessed. "I spend way too much time at my computer."
"Maybe you ought to ride more often. It's good for the soul."
She smiled. "I agree, but I'm not sure there's enough ibuprofen in the world to get me through the tenderfoot stage." JP thought of offering Sara a couple of Advil and or a cup of coffee, but she'd already said she needed to get back to work on her novel, and he didn't want to come off as, well, needy.
"You'll be all right," he assured her. "Damn, McCall," he told himself silently. "You're an eloquent son of a gun."
"I don't have much of a choice," Sara pointed out lightly, without a trace of self-pity. "None of us do, really." She was headed toward her car, parked beside his truck, and JP walked alongside her. It was the polite thing to do, but this was more than good manners, and he knew it. This was reluctance to part. He was about to bite the bullet and ask Sara to come back soon for another long ride, when she opened her car door, reached inside, and pulled out her purse. It was plain, though trimmed with fringe. JP held up both his hands.
"Don't," he said.
Sara frowned.
But nothing, Sara.
I don't want money. He paused, feeling stupid and awkward. You're my best friend's sister. She tilted her head back, smiled at him, and he marveled at how beautiful she was. He'd always known that, hadn't he? So why hadn't it sunk in? Okay, but I demand a compromise.
Such as?
Her smile broadened, brightened. You have to let me buy you dinner. We can go to Bailey's or Sully's, anywhere you choose.
Suddenly he was 14 again, all knees and elbows and Adam's apple.
She looked worried. Unless you're seeing someone. It's just a friendly dinner, but I wouldn't want to cause trouble.
I'm not seeing anyone, he said,
a little more quickly than he would have liked. Sara wasn't suggesting a date, he reminded himself. Just a casual meal to repay him for a favor.
Sarah's smile returned, nearly setting JP back on the scuffed heels of his boots.
All right, then. When?
Tonight, JP said, and it felt like a risk, which was ridiculous. It wasn't as if he were about to jump out of a low-flying plane without a chute, but it sure felt like that.
Tonight will be great. Is Bailey's okay?
Bailey's is fine. Shall I pick you up, or do you want to meet me there?
Sara beamed at him. JP tried to catch his breath. Let's meet there. 7 o'clock, Sara said.
JP gulped, searched for his voice, found it. See you at 7, he said.
Excellent, Sara chimed. And then she rose onto the balls of her feet and kissed him lightly on his stubbly cheek. Before he could respond in any way, except of course for the flipping sensation somewhere in his midsection, Sara was behind the wheel of her car. He watched, rooted to the ground, as she fastened her seatbelt, started the engine, shifted out of park, and drove away. He was still standing there when she honked the horn in farewell. He didn't move until Trooper bumped against him, looking for attention and possibly some extra kibble, snapping him out of immobility. JP chuckled and mussed the dog's ears. After putting the lead ropes away in the barn, they went inside the house, the spacious but unassuming ranch house JP had grown up in. It was his now, since both his sisters were busy professionals settled in homes of their own, and his folks preferred their compact A-frame. He washed his hands at the kitchen sink, gave Trooper a dog biscuit, and glanced at his laptop, open and booted up on the round oak table that, like much of the furniture, had belonged to JP's great-grandparents. Usually the computer drew him, no matter what the time of day or night. But today was different. Today, his mind was reeling with thoughts of Sara. Memories of her warm smile, her shining eyes, her throaty laugh.
Chapter 2.
You have an actual date? Sarah's 16-year-old daughter, Haley, asked, blue eyes wide, blonde ponytail bouncing with emphasis as Sara set two places at the kitchen table, one for each of her children.
No, Sara muttered in response. I'm meeting a friend for dinner, that's all.
You're pretty dressed up, Haley remarked rather slyly.
Who is this friend?
None of your business, kiddo, Sara replied patiently.
You're meeting a guy, the kid insisted. Admit it, Mom. You have a date.
That's enough, Sara warned, exasperated. Tell your brother it's time to eat, please.
Instead of heading for the living room, where Eric was probably engrossed in his phone, Haley threw back her head and shouted,
Eric, supper's ready, and Mom has a date with some guy.
Sara sighed, distracted and a little nervous. Neither she nor JP had used the word date when they agreed to meet at Bailey's at 7 p.m. and share a meal.
Haley, she said, feigning a glare.
Haley shrugged in that irritatingly dismissive way of teenagers
turned on one sneakered heel, and pushed open the door leading to the living room, leaping back when Eric appeared in the space, looking concerned.
Seriously? You're going on a date? He asked,
taking in her black jeans, shell top, and short turquoise jacket.
Is that a smart thing to do?
Oh, for heaven's sake, Sara protested. I'm meeting a friend for an ordinary dinner. It's no big deal.
Eric frowned. Unlike Haley, he resembled her rather than her ex-husband, and his gray eyes were troubled.
Whatever you say, he said.
Wash up and eat your supper, Sara said, unwilling to discuss her plans for the evening any further, at least with these two.
And I expect the dishwasher to be loaded and the kitchen tidied by the time I get home.
It's Eric's turn, Haley pointed out. He can take time out from texting Carly to do his chores.
The relationship between Eric and Carly Hollister, Cord and Shally's daughter, was an on-and-off kind of thing. And frankly, it worried Sara a little. Eric was younger than Carly by a little over a year, less mature emotionally, too. And when September rolled around, Carly would be off to college in L.A., while Eric stayed behind to repeat his senior year, and hopefully graduate this time around. Life and young love being what they were, he'd be left behind in more ways than one. And while Sara knew that was the way things worked, she dreaded her son's reaction. Flustered because she was due at Bailey's in less than 10 minutes, and already fending off a low-grade panic attack, Sara made a mental note to ask Eli to have a talk with Eric, try to prepare him for the inevitable changes headed his way.
I don't care whose turn it is, she retorted, frowning at Eric, then Haley. I'm looking for results here, not arguments.
Grumbling ensued, but Sara paid no attention. Call or text if you need me, she said over one shoulder, as she headed for the door that opened into the garage, car keys in hand, purse tucked under one arm. Behind her, the grumbling shifted to mild bickering. Situation normal. Inside her car, Sara pushed the button that would open the garage door, started the engine, backed out onto her driveway, buzzed the door down again, and drove away from her brick house. Because she didn't want to think about whether or not the kids were right, and she was about to go out on a date with J.P. McCall, Sara considered her clunky car. It ran well, and it was paid for, but it was the automotive equivalent of mom jeans. Maybe she ought to spring for something a little more sporty, a roadster, perhaps, like the one her sister-in-law and close friend Bryn drove, or more properly, had driven. Since starting her business and the birth of her and Eli's twin sons, toddlers now, Bryn got around town in a minivan most of the time, though she still owned the roadster and used it whenever the babies were with Eli or their grandparents. Sara could certainly afford a new car, but she couldn't see herself in anything flashy or in a minivan. Eric and Haley were far beyond the car seat stage, obviously, and while that was a relief in a lot of ways, it was also a secret sorrow. She'd loved being the mother of small children, despite the problems of being a single parent. But she definitely didn't miss the financial struggles, the sleepless nights, and bone-deep fatigue, the constant vigilance required to keep her little ones safe and well. Sara still loved being a mother, though. If anything, it was even harder now that Eric and Haley were almost grown, and thus more independent. Not to mention more dramatic, and often either sullen or surly. To be fair, Haley had been an easy child, and she was essentially good-natured, too. Sara missed the little girl version of her daughter, tiny and sweet, pirouetting around the living room in her ballet shoes and a sparkly tutu, crowing, "Look at me, Mommy, look at me." Eric, on the other hand, had been a challenge from the moment puberty kicked in. A moody kid, sensitive to slights, real or imagined, and often bitter over not having a father. God knew Eli had stepped up, but in the final analysis, he was Eric's uncle, not his dad. And now that he had children of his own, Eli had less time for Eric. Sara loved her son, but in the privacy of her own head, she could admit that she wished he were easier to deal with. Eric had never been a sunny child like Haley. He'd been quiet, studious, and shy. Most likely he'd been bullied early on, though to this day he wouldn't say one way or the other. Today, both her kids were in that bewildering space where they were neither children nor adults, but struggling, sometimes fiercely, to leave their childhoods, and it sometimes seemed her as well, behind for good. She arrived at Bailey's, a popular restaurant and bar widely acknowledged as a community gathering place, with nothing resolved, either where her children were concerned or with the date or just a friendly dinner dilemma. The place was hopping tonight, and for the first time it occurred to Sara that the other diners, probably all locals and therefore people she knew, might draw some conclusions of their own when they saw her and JP seated at the same table and obviously, well, together. Sara Worth, she said aloud as she tucked her compact car into a parking space. You're making way too much of this. J.P. McCall might be hot. Okay, he's molten. But you've known him forever. He's your brother's friend, and he probably thinks of you as an older sister. An older sister, Sara thought glumly. Yikes. She wasn't that much older than J.P., only 2 years. The attempt to reassure herself fell flat. Their actual ages, hers and JP's, didn't matter. But that didn't mean JP thought of her as what she was, a healthy, successful, and reasonably attractive woman. He'd gone riding with her that morning, yes, and he'd agreed to meet her for dinner. But he probably considered this little get-together a simple favor. Heat surged up Sarah's neck to pound in her cheeks. Was she making a fool of herself? Should she text JP, offer some excuse, and go home? A tap sounded at the driver's side window, and Sara turned to see JP standing beside her car. He looked way too good, in a newish pair of jeans and a crisp white shirt, open at the throat. His sand-colored hair shone, even in the dim light of Bailey's parking lot, and his easy smile struck Sara squarely in the midsection. She rolled down her window, ready to claim she had a headache, a chicken-shit excuse if she'd ever heard one, and stared into that familiar, devastatingly handsome face. How had she watched J.P. McCall grow from a scrawny ranch kid to a man without noticing, until today, just how good-looking he really was? Are you coming inside? He asked, his smile relaxing into a slight tilt at one corner of his mouth. Bryn is holding a table for us. Sara found her voice, but barely. Sure, yes. He reached for the handle, pulled open the door. Sara started to get out of the car, was stopped by her seatbelt and blushed again. Head down, she fumbled to unfasten it. JP either didn't notice the awkward movement or pretended he hadn't. Sara drew a deep breath and admonished herself, silently of course, to get a goddamned grip. He was standing just far enough away to allow Sara a place to stand, and he extended a hand to help her. It was a chivalrous thing to do, but a sense of chagrin flashed through Sara, as though she were an old lady he was helping to cross the street. Sara pushed the car door shut and locked it using her key fob. She was behaving like an idiot, she knew that, but she couldn't seem to break the pattern. You look beautiful, JP said very quietly. Was that a pity compliment, offered only because she was so clearly, stupidly nervous? Thank you, she said, forcing herself to relax a little, a very little. His hand rested lightly against the small of her back as they crossed the parking lot to the sidewalk and headed for the restaurant's front door. Bailey's was noisy and brightly lit that night, as always, and friends and neighbors waved and called out the occasional howdy as J.P. steered Sara very gently toward a side table where Bryn was waiting, menus in hand, a big smile on her face. Bryn, a stunningly beautiful blonde any day of the week, absolutely glowed with happiness and well-being. Married life suited her. Occasionally, she helped out at Bailey's, probably because her parents, though lively, were definitely getting older. Sara loved her sister-in-law dearly. They'd been friends long before she and Eli got together. But in that moment, she wished Bryn wasn't making such a big fuss. She greeted Sara with a kiss on the cheek and invited JP and Sara to sit with a grand gesture of one hand. JP, slightly flushed along his jawline, Sara suddenly noticed, cleared his throat and drew back a chair for her. Sara sank into it, feeling winded, as though she'd just run a marathon or a gauntlet. JP took a seat opposite Sara, and when their gazes met, he winked. Something about the gesture eased the tension, and Sara relaxed. This was a dinner with a friend, not a date, and that was okay. It was fine, really. Coffee? Bryn asked. Or wine? JP asked for a beer, and Sara echoed the request. Somebody popped some coins into the jukebox, and a few moments later, Brad Paisley launched into alcohol. Bryn walked away, and Sara and JP perused their menus. I'm buying, Sara reminded JP without looking up from her menu. She felt, rather than saw, his grin. It was warm, like an afternoon breeze in high summer. Okay, he agreed affably. Sara risked a glance and saw that his hazel eyes were alight with amusement. I mean it, she bumbled on. Get steak, if that's what you want. Sara, he said. His voice was gruff and his eyes were still laughing, though not in a derisive way. What? She croaked. Relax, he replied. I don't bite. Well, that's a pity, Sara thought, with a sweet secret shiver. Her wild side, she definitely had one, was trying to come out. She wasn't having it. She tried to sound businesslike. I'm fine, she said briskly. And then she stuck her foot squarely in her mouth. This isn't a date, after all. JP raised one eyebrow, and that twitch was there again at the corner of his mouth. Isn't it? He asked. Sara blushed, skirted his gaze. She was at a complete loss for words, which was probably for the best, given that she'd already made an idiot of herself. Bryn saved her from having to respond by bringing two tall mugs of foamy, bubbling beer to the table. Made up your minds? She chimed. Sara swallowed. Yes, she muttered. I'll have the meatloaf special, please, with a dinner salad to start. Bryn scribbled the order onto her paper pad and turned her dazzling smile to JP. How about you, cowboy? She asked. JP smiled back, closed the menu with a resolute snap. T-bone, he replied. Medium rare, fries on the side and hold the salad. Got it, Bryn said, accepting the offered menu and taking Sara's too. And then she hustled away. Mike and Alice must be taking the night off, JP observed when the silence had stretched well into the next song in the jukebox queue. Johnny Cash, I Walk the Line. Folks around the creek liked the classics. They're probably upstairs, looking after the twins, Sara said, relieved that the conversation had taken a turn toward the ordinary. Bryn's folks were devoted grandparents, and the apartment was handy to the restaurant. Until her marriage to Eli, Bryn had lived up there. Now the place served as a sort of rest area, and when needed, quarters for out-of-town guests. JP grasped the handle of his mug, lifted it in a toast. To remembering how it feels to ride a horse, he said. Sara tapped her mug against his in acknowledgement, and took such a big gulp of the brew that she nearly choked on it. JP watched her, his head tilted slightly to one side.
Did you finish the manuscript?
Poor guy. He was trying so hard to make things easier. That or he was simply enjoying her discomfort. He'd teased her plenty when they were kids, usually in concert with Eli and Cord.
Sort of, Sara answered with a deep, grateful sigh. I'll have revisions to do after my editor reads the book. Once those are done, I'll take a few weeks off to recover, then start the next project. My publisher already accepted the proposal.
What do you do when you're recovering? He asked moderately.
Sara felt much calmer by then, but the pit of her stomach was still fluttering. She made a shrug-like motion with her shoulders, hoping to come off as casual and unflustered, and replied,
I read a lot. Not research books, but novels. I like mysteries.
She enjoyed romances, too, the sexier the better, but she wasn't about to say so at this juncture. JP didn't need to know that her love life was entirely vicarious.
I try to make up for all the exercise I missed sitting in front of my computer by swimming laps at the community center and taking a few yoga classes.
Sounds good, JP said.
What do you do? Sara heard herself ask. To relax, I mean. He smiled.
Mainly I ride. I like to read, too.
That caught Sarah's interest.
Really?
Yeah, really, he answered with a touch of kindly irony. I've been doing that since first grade.
Sara made a face, barely noticed when Bryn set her salad down in front of her.
What kinds of books do you like?
Yours, he replied, among others.
He read her books? Sara was surprised, though she probably shouldn't have been. She was good at what she did, and lots of people read her novels, if she did say so herself, which she didn't.
What else? She asked, to keep from leaping right in and asking what he'd liked best about her books and what he thought could be improved upon.
Grisham, King, Barclay, Kuntz, Coben, he said.
His voice trailed off, leaving Sara with the distinct impression that the list was considerably longer.
No female authors? She countered, though diplomatically.
Like I said, you.
Sara blushed again, but less fiercely this time, took up her fork and picked at her salad.
And others?
And others, he confirmed.
I don't suppose you'd be willing to read the manuscript I just finished?
She asked, without meaning to at all. The job of first reader usually fell to Eli, since, like her series character, he was both a man and a law enforcement officer. But he was busy these days with his job and growing family. Too late, she realized, she was asking a great deal of a casual friend. She nearly facepalmed. But JP seemed pleased.
I'd like that, he said.
Sara took a few moments to take that in.
For real?
He said nothing, just looked at her, and waited.
You'll be honest, she asked. Tell me if something doesn't ring true.
I'll be honest, he assured her.
Thanks.
Sara?
What?
This is a date, isn't it?
I don't know, she answered. Is it?
JP chuckled.
I think so, he said.
She didn't comment. Their food arrived, and for several blessed minutes they were both occupied with the mechanics of eating. Sara was amazed to find that she wasn't just hungry, she was ravenous. She'd had a light breakfast, toast and half a banana, before heading out to the McCall place that morning, come straight home after the ride with JP, taken a quick shower and changed clothes, then lost herself in polishing certain scenes in her novel. She'd forgotten all about lunch, hadn't even bothered with a snack.
This is so good, she said, referring to the meatloaf special she'd ordered. It came with mashed potatoes, tomato gravy, and green beans. How's your steak?
JP chewed thoughtfully, swallowed, and answered in his own good time.
Never a bad meal here at Bailey's, he replied.
Another pause followed while he took another bite of steak and washed it down with a few sips of beer. Sara was privately comparing her emotional state to a minor whirlwind. Even before she'd taken up writing fiction, she'd thought in pictures. When JP asked a question that nearly caused her to choke.
When was the last time you went out with a man, Sara?
She forced herself to meet his eyes and found amiable curiosity there, rather than the challenge she'd half expected.
I've been pretty busy, she replied. You know, with the kids and my career and everything.
He said.
What does that mean? Sara asked.
For some reason, his response prickled. Before JP could reply, though, she countered, when was the last time you went out on a date?
He looked away very briefly, then looked back, holding her gaze.
Saturday night, he answered.
Today was Wednesday. Obviously, unlike her, the man had a life. She felt herself shrink a little, wishing she hadn't asked that particular question. The food remaining on her plate, so delicious only moments before, had lost all appeal. JP surprised her, again. He reached across the table, took her hand. His skin was warm, strong, and a little rough from hard work. JP McCall was more than a stock market wizard. He was a rancher. He rode fence lines, herded cattle, bucked bales of hay. And his touch shot gentle fire through Sarah's veins. It was then that she first admitted to herself that she wanted more of this man's touch. A lot more.
Hey, he said, I shouldn't have asked you about your private life. It's none of my business.
Sara couldn't speak. The fire had fanned out from her hand to blaze in the rest of her body and, damn it, in her face.
I keep getting this wrong, JP said, still holding her hand.
For some reason, she imagined slow dancing with JP in a semi-darkened room with a smoky playlist pulsing low in the background. She'd missed so much playing it safe.
You're not getting anything wrong, Sara protested too quickly. It's me. This is all so awkward.
It doesn't have to be, he suggested.
Oh, but it does, Sara said, keeping her voice down,
suddenly aware that she and JP were still drawing sidelong glances from the other patrons of the restaurant.
I can't remember the last time I felt like such an idiot.
Somehow JP had finished most of his meal, while Sara had merely nibbled.
You're anything but an idiot, Sara. You're just, well, a little out of practice when it comes to making small talk.
A pause.
Or maybe I was right before, and I'm getting this wrong.
She laughed then, actually laughed. And it was a tremendous relief.
You? J.P. McCall, the most sought-after bachelor in Wild Horse County, now that Eli and Cord are off the market?
Instead of the cocky grin Sara might have expected, J.P. responded with a frown.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.